Hashem, tonight we're going to be speaking about Melechet Tzoveh, prohibition of coloring on Shabbat. Coloring is one of the 39 prohibitions of Torah, and on Shabbat, in laws of Shabbat, we learn it from the building of the Mishkan. They built the tabernacle, and they were supposed to color the orot, the skins that they used to keep the Mishkan inside of it. So halacha is, for that reason, this melacha is prohibited. And whoever does any kind of coloring on Shabbat with a permanent marker or permanent things on Shabbat, and we'll bring now the example. For example, if a person has a shoe and he would like to color his shoes on Shabbat, can he do it? Like they have a black shoes, sometimes they rub a little bit and the different color come out. So what people do, they take the black color, the shoe polish, black color shoe polish, and they start to polish their shoes. Can you do it on Shabbat? Yeah. You are prohibited to do so on Shabbat. Now, what could you do? That's it? One of the prohibitions of Torah on Shabbat is to color. And as we mentioned, this melacha is from Mishkan, so therefore, anything that with a permanent color would be prohibited to color this on Shabbat. Anything with not permanent color, it's still prohibited on Shabbat when we don't do this. One of the examples that we brought, it was to color your shoes, as regularly people do. They choose a black shoe polish for black shoes, and a brown for brown, and red for red, and that's how they make it look presentable. Right? On Shabbat, you would not be allowed to color this on Shabbat. But in the general, to clean the shoes, if you take some dry material and you just wipe the shoe from all around, that's not prohibited. But to color the shoe, this is would be prohibited from the Rabbanan. And if it's a permanent color, it would be prohibited from Torah. Now, a woman with cosmetics on Shabbat. That's the most question that found between the ladies always on Shabbat. So would you be allowed to do this on Shabbat or not? Even the color is not permanent, but still halacha is for women are not allowed to do any type of coloring on their face on Shabbat. Whether it's some rose color srak, it's called something, how do you call it?
Rouge blush,
whatever, or you put, I don't know how you call it in English.
Eyeshadow.
So, eyeshadows, or you put this eye marker, right?
Eyeliner.
And or on your lips.
Lipstick
on lips liner. They also do to emphasize the lips to be beautiful for their husbands. This, all those things you have to do before Shabbat. Now, what do you do after Shabbat? Meaning in the morning. And whole face look like a... So every lady is familiar with that. So one lady, she called me and she asked me this question. What do I do? Now, can you take it off? Halacha is to wash it off, you're allowed. The question is, then you look like I don't know what.
Natural,
right. Let's say like this. And sometimes husbands, they don't like natural colors. So... And they need more vivid colors. So what do you do? So that's what the woman lady called me, because it was 3 days in a row, Rosh Hashanah, Rosh Hashanah, Shabbat. Mm-hmm. Said, Rabbi, what do I do? My husband going to turn away from me. So I said, listen, I don't know the remedy for this issue, but I know a very powerful thing that will help you. Said, what do you mean? You never take, I mean, you tried everything, Shisha, I tried everything, I need to be with this coloring on the face. So I said, there's a most powerful thing that called tefillah. Prayer. So what do you mean, Rabbi? What should I pray for? I said, pray to HaKadosh Baruch Hu that you should find a favor in eyes of your husband without any chemistry on your face. That's all. It's so simple. It says, "Vatihi Esther noset chen be'ene kol ro'eha." In 1 month, we're going to have Purim. It says Esther, Vatihi Esther noset chen be'ene ro'eya. Esther, she was found beautiful and pretty in eyes of anyone who saw her. You know how old Esther was at that time? You're going to be shocked. She was always 70 years old. She was over 70 years old, Gemara says. Did you see 70 years old lady and everybody look at her like a Miss World? Miss Universe? So what do you think about this? Chen HaKadosh Baruch Hu gives. The pretty beauty gives Hashem. So pray to this. Pray to HaKadosh Baruch Hu and say, Ribono Shel Olam, give me a natural beauty of Bat Israel so my husband should not look to other women. He should look at me without any chemistry on my face. So she said, yeah, okay, and she never called back. So I hope everything worked out.
I mean, I could understand if men have chen on their face, because men don't need to put on makeup.
Well, ladies do have also, and if she prays, she will get. And check it, please.
But they do have Shabbat makeup.
Shabbat. Who has this makeup?
No, before Shabbat.
And they have essential makeup. They say you could use it on Shabbat.
Yeah. Who said that? Okay, so let me just tell you how does it work. Okay, before you said that they said that, you have to find out who said it. The only thing, halacha, so I told you, let's go in order. I'll tell you that about Shabbat makeup. Okay? Now, the number one, the face to put a rose color blush or whatever you call it, you're not allowed to. On the eyes, you're not allowed to put any color. Doesn't matter what kind of base it has, oily base, not oily base, it's regular base. It doesn't matter what, it's a color. Mm-hmm. You're not allowed to color. And a siftun, lipstick. You're not allowed to put the lipstick on Shabbat either.
What if it doesn't have color?
Like no.
Chapstick.
Okay, the chapstick, it might be two different problems. Number one, you want this to be as a moist on your lips, it might be memareach. On Shabbat, you don't do this because of issue of smearing.
So what if you dab it? If you do it, you know.
Yeah, like this. In this case, it's not going to be whatever. But still, if you do it in the purposes of treatment, it would be also Oseh Rufot on Shabbat. Yeah, Rufot on Shabbat, you're not allowed to do this. But what I would advise for you, you take a little bit of oil, olive oil, and put it on like this. It's going to be the same effect and permit it on Shabbat. There is no prohibition.
Why
olive oil is allowed? Isn't it also smearing?
Oil is allowed, but not something that solid substance like a lipstick. Lipstick is not oil. Lipstick is something solid.
But that's what also the rolling, you know, the rolling one?
Right.
That's also is a deodorant.
Rolling what?
Rolling. So lipstick or deodorant. But lipstick without a color, that's the one I have, the rolling one.
Rolling, is it liquid as oil?
It's oil. Liquid.
If it's liquid and oil, there's no prohibition. And if it's with a color,
no,
that's prohibited. Yeah,
no,
if
oil,
it's no color,
clear,
you're allowed. If it's liquid, again,
it's
yes.
Liquid.
And as long as you don't put it for the purpose of a medicine, as a medicine. You put it just to be nice, in order to feel better with your lips and whatever. Right?
Okay, this thing about purpose of the medicine, can we take vitamins on Shabbat? It's okay.
It depends for what issue you're taking. If you're taking as a supplemental for the food because you don't like to eat so much food, and for example, I saw some people, they take vitamins instead of food.
It's
I don't
just
know.
Low on vitamins.
So, yeah, so if it's part of the food, in my book of Shabbat Kodesh, I wrote you allowed to take it,
mm-hmm.
because it's not like a medicine. But if a person's sick, Meaning he's not chole sheyesh bo sakana, he's not dangerously sick. He's a regular sick person, and the doctor said he has to take a vitamins for that purpose. So what he does with this vitamins, he takes before Shabbat and after Shabbat. On Shabbat itself, he doesn't take. So before Shabbat, before putting candles, he takes it. And after Shabbat, after Abdullah, he takes another pill.
Okay, one more thing. You say you could wash off the makeup.
Right.
Can we use the, you know, those makeup removers?
What is makeup?
Can
wives, you have to explain first of all, do they reap from each other?
No,
they separate. They pre-ripped ones. Okay, now, pre-separated ones. Are
like
they,
baby wipes.
How, yeah, I understand. How moist are they? Are they too much moist that they could squeeze them?
No,
what are
no,
they made of? Synthetic material?
No, Yeah, so maybe feel like the baby wipes.
Like
no,
baby
that
wipes.
But they're not so much moist that you could squeeze them.
No.
If you use them benachad, if you use them with very carefully, you will have to use them.
Okay. How about the
but you cannot make towel wet. Again, don't understand from here. You cannot wet your towel, squeeze it, and then go and round your
really
it's a
whole
different.
Okay, that, but what about, there's another one, let's say in a bottle, I can't take a tissue, just put it up, dab it on there, and just smear it off.
It depends how much you moist it. Don't dip it so much, so it becomes soaked. A little bit if you take, yes. And my advice to you, a medical advice for you, do not use this chemistry on your skin at all. Why? I'll tell you why. Because it damages and makes your process of aging of your face even faster. That's a production of this chemicals. They need customers, okay? And if you want to use a natural remedy, one of them I told you already. The second one, any time that the woman is healthy with going to bathroom, she would have natural color on her face. She would not need this, thanks. You understand that? Okay, that's the medical advice for you. Don't use this chemistry on it. It's dangerous chemistry. If you read ingredients and you do understand what ingredients say, you would not take it even in your hands, those things.
Isn't that aluminum matter?
Yes. You know what it says? It has aluminum inside. It has to have aluminum. It has all very not good metals inside. So you have to be very careful what you're using.
You're talking about the makeup remover or the actual makeup?
Doesn't matter what. Makeup or makeup remover, both of them. It's a chemicals and be careful of using it too much on your skin. That's it, I said. Now, be careful. Well, if this is up to your discretion. It's not up to me. I'm just saying to you an advice not to use it too much. Now, the laka. Is a woman allowed to put...
No.
A lock.
Nail polish.
They make a colors without the colors, with the colors. Problem for Shabbat, you definitely not allowed, even the one without the color. You're not allowed to put it. Because what about for different problems? Let's say you did it before Shabbat, everything is nice, and a woman needs to go to mikveh. Minhag of kosher woman today to take off the nail polish before the mikveh. They do take it off because that's a minhag and they cut off the nails and etc. But let's say there are certain ladies, they too much into those issues and they don't want to take it off. So Halacha says in this case, anything made for beauty is permitted to keep, meaning even she goes to mikveh and even for netilat yaday. Okay, now, what about if this cracks? Ladies, they don't like they cracked colors on their fingers, right? They want to get rid of it. So the halakha is chatzitza. Chatzitza, it means it will separate between you and water while doing the telat yadayim or while going to mikveh. So halakha is you should be taking off those nail polishes before you do the telat yadayim or before you go to mikveh. Because it's cracked, it's not for beauty. Anything that's not for beauty, the chatzitza. It's chotzetz, it's chatzitza, it means it's separating between you and water, and you have to be careful with that. Now,
so we could take it off on Shabbat?
On Shabbat, you're not allowed to take it off, but let's say it happens such a thing, and you already in mikveh on Shabbat. So in this case, Rav Ovadia Yosef permits to call a goya, a non-Jew, that she should take off for you that. Yes.
Question. They allow to dip the hands without the cotton in the acetone.
That's what they do? Well, it will not go by itself. You have to use something to do it like this. But that's for that reason, no, you cannot do that. So what do? You call goy.
You know
what you could do? No, you were supposed to prepare before. You have to pick
up.
So what do you do in this case? In this case, you better to prepare before, but if you didn't prepare, you call it goy. But if you could wash it like this, and it goes itself, but I doubt it, because you need to clean all sides of this, yes.
What if you're comfortable with it? I heard if you're comfortable with your hands looking the way they are, and you're comfortable to go
out there. Well, we're not going according to what you want. We go according to the majority of the ladies in this case. Majority of the ladies, they don't want such a lack on their nail polish, on their nails. They want to get rid of this because it doesn't look nice for them. It doesn't go according to what you want. It goes according to the majority of the ladies, okay? Now, let's go further. About Shabbat makeup. Mistakenly, people understand that somebody permits Shabbat makeup. The only thing that permitted for Shabbat, it's a powder with no color. Powder with no color, it is permitted.
What's the point?
Wow.
It's
amazing.
Makeup, bare essential.
I don't know what it is. I don't know the names, but I'm telling you rules how to go with it. Alaha is any makeup that has a color, you're not allowed to put on yourself on Shabbat, no matter how it says for Shabbat or not for Shabbat. Because marketing, they will go going to go and write for you, even our Wadia permits it. You check it before. It's not for Shabbat. Anything that has a color, you're not allowed to put on yourself and you color yourself. That's halacha. Something with no color, it's not oily also. It's only powder. You're allowed to put on Shabbat in order to whiten your face. To make it white powder, it's without the color, you're allowed to put it
it's
on
a
your
natural back. Color?
It's natural color, yeah.
No, let's say powder is natural, it's not white, but naturally.
He says it's here with colorless. Color. He has colorless, you should put the colorless things. Well, that's what he says here. Yes. You see, there are many, many problems involved in this. You see, the problems, the Rabbanan, and, you know, I would call the Goya. You go outside, you find a Goya, you say, listen, after Shabbat, they might pay you also for that. Please come help us. That's all. Okay? You do not do it yourself because Isurei the Rabbanan, nobody permits for that issue. Now, person who eats fruits that leave the color around the mouth. You know, sometimes if you take a fruit like a certain strawberry or berries or whatever, and he eats the color left around, or color left on the tongue, or ices, whatever. Yeah, by the way, those ices that you eat also full of chemicals, so be careful. So those chemical colors, be careful of those. That ruins the body. So again, halacha is, it is permitted since you do not think to color anything, you just think to eat something, and it becomes naturally, there is no problem, especially with a woman with the beets, when she cuts the beets, the whole hands are full of beets color, so in this case, there is no problem, you could wash them well, but some say, now, the question is, afterwards, can I just take a towel and wipe them on a towel? Now, if you do have colorful towel, it's no problem. But if you have a white towel, what will happen? It kind of looks like you're coloring the towel. So what do you do before? You better. It's better for you to wash your hands first, than to wipe it on a towel or on a tissue or whatever you have there. Now, that's because of that reason, some machmirim, it's a chumrah, rabotai, it's not chobah, it's a chumrah that they put colorful napkins on the table on Shabbat. In order not to color white, you know, because whenever it is a white, the color right away appears, and that's what the color becomes. But white napkins are permitted on Shabbat. There's no problem because nobody has it in his mind to color those napkins. They just make them dirty and throw it away. Therefore, it is permitted to use. Somebody who had a wound. And the wound is bleeding, I like to put white bandages on it because what eventually will happen, the blood will go over and will color the bandage. Halacha is, you cannot prohibit this because of Tzovei HaBeged, because nobody has an intention to color the bandage. They opposite, they want the bandage to stay clean as long as possible to keep it. Now, so therefore, we could rely on those authorities who permit to put white band-aids on their wounds on Shabbat, there's no prohibition to do so.
But stop bleeding. You want to stop bleeding.
Right. Some people, they have problems of bleeding in the nose. They have, sometimes happens. So how do you stop the bleeding? The best way to do it, just to press it here like this for 1 minute, to breathe it with the mouth, and then to open it and breathe it with the nose. When you press on capillaries, what happens, they go together and they don't let certain minute for two, don't let the blood to go through those capillaries, and they just close themselves. Try this. If it doesn't help, it is permitted to use a tissue, even it's white, to close your nose in order the blood should stop and not go further. Yes, you had a question?
The cream, you know, before the bandage, you can put a cream so it heals faster. Can you also apply that one?
On your body, you don't put your cream, but on a bandaid, you could have put the cream, and with the bandaid together, you could put it together. Don't smear it on yourself. Okay? Halachically, again, this is refuah, and if it's dangerous, again, somebody cutting himself with a knife, it might be dangerous because of tetanus, or how do you call it? Some infection might fall from the knife, which is rusted sometimes. So what do? You could put this medicine in order to get it. It's not a problem.
Question.
Yes.
You said oil you're allowed to smear on your hand for the purpose of pleasure, right? Because you want it up. But how about lotion? But for the purpose of good smell. It's not for the purpose of healing, but lotion.
How liquid is that? Is it liquid?
It's a
little cream. Yeah, it's
more less than cream, yeah.
I told you last time on Motzei Shabbat that there is a Ovadia, Yitzchak Yosef. He says, as long as you do it for the pleasure and you do not leave it on your body, you smear it in totally inside, he permits it. As long as it's not on the hair area. Okay? For what? For what do you do cream from the face? Again, to feel, this is for Onik Shabbat. Again, you do for skin therapy or you do for Onik Shabbat, to enjoy it on Shabbat. It's two different things. You see, she likes the smell of the lotion. She enjoying it. To do this, you are permitted on Shabbat.
Maybe
but
the
if
women
you
have
do
dry
it,
skin and they do it every day.
So they do it because of what? They do it because of medicine. In this case, they would do one before Shabbat and one after Shabbat.
What about some
we don't put it on Shabbat. On Shabbat, we don't put it. Okay, now, are we allowed to put timukim, raisins, into a water, to keep them in the water? But in the time, what will happen, raisins, they will blow up, and some of color of the raisins will go into water, and water will become like different color. Are you allowed to do this? He says there's no prohibition to do so. The only prohibition was to leave dio, the ink in the water. In those times, they used to do dehydrated ink. How do you do it? It's like a cube of a black ink or cube of a red ink. They put it in the water, they mix it with the water, and it becomes dye. Do you understand that? So that's how they used to do dio, the ink, in those times. But since you just put the fruit in the water, and the water, because of that, changed the color, it is not called coloring, so therefore you're allowed to do this on Shabbat, and there is no problem. Now, is there coloring for food? For example, you want your food to look like with red color, and you put karkom inside. Karkom, it's a cute, how do you call it? Karkom, yeah, it's paprika. Might be paprika. To look, yeah, to look red. Karkom, no, it's karkom, it's
paprika makes everything red.
Paprika is
curry,
no? Curry.
It's like a very deep red, brownish red.
Curry is yellow.
It's not curry.
Curry is red.
It's called karkom. Kurkumin, it's called. Kurkumin, I think it's called. So if you put it and it colors the food and becomes like reddish, nice color food, halacha is, since it's spice, and there is no problem with the coloring that. Or for example, bread, you dip into
avocado, quina.
No problem, you could do that. There's no problem. If you dip the bread into a tomato sauce and bread becomes red, there's no problem, because it's for the food, there's no problem to do so either. Or you take a cookie and you start to dip a cookie in orange juice. The cookie is white color, let's say. You dip it in orange juice, you would like to eat it, or whatever, with that coffee. Coffee is different color. You dip it inside, and the cookie color is in different color. Halacha is, it is permitted, there's no problem with that.
And it's because you don't want it to happen, it's a byproduct, meaning it happens, but it's not.
No, it's, there's no, yesh lanu klal, en tzvi'a be'ochalim. There is no coloring for food on Shabbat. There's no problem. Now, the same law applies, let's say I have a water for the drinks, en tzvi'a be'mashkin, the same law, something I would like to drink. I have a water and I would like to mix it with some wine. And what will become eventually? The water will be colored with the wine.
Right.
Am I allowed to do so?
So
yes, it is. You're allowed to do so. Or you take a tea bag on the third cup, right? You put a tea bag in the third cup. And what becomes? The water, which is clear, it becomes colored with the tea, whatever tea you like. There are herbal teas you have, and all kind of variety of the teas. So you're allowed to do this on Shabbat. There is no prohibition for that.
So you know the green tea, the Chinese green tea? The one that all the Bukharians like?
Mm-hmm.
That's allowed to make it, right? Yes.
How do you make it proper way? So I'll tell you, probably two lessons ago, you were not here, so I'll tell you how to do it proper way. The tea leaves, they're considered easy boiling things. Easy boiling things, we have to be very careful not to put in the first vessel. First vessel considered the one that you keep it on the source of the heat. On a fire, on a platter, or on an electric. That's called first vessel. Over there you're not allowed to put, because once you put it, they're going to boil there. And it's boiling on Shabbat, you're cooking on Shabbat. You're not allowed to do this. Now, what do? You spill it in the second cup. Once you spill it in the second cup, the vessel itself will cool off a little bit temperature. Then you spill it in the third. The third vessel is considered, even if it's hot, it cannot cook anymore. The temperature of the vessel cannot cook anymore. So what do? In the third cup, you're allowed to put. So regularly how we do it, from the, let's say, electric urn, we put it in a teapot. We bring it to the table, so it's a second already. You put it in the cup. It's going to be third. Then you put, after you put the water inside, you put the dry tea. Then you put it back. That's all. That's how.
And then you can put it from the teapot, or you put on right on top of the hot
right.
water.
Right. No. It has to be third cup first.
No. Where you steam the leaves, it's in the third cup. Now you put it in the teapot,
right.
But now you want to add more hot water to the teapot, so should you do the third vessel or the second vessel?
You could do it straight. If it's left, you could do it straight.
Because it's already boiled in the third.
Right. It's not. Now. Water, no. Water doesn't cook. You do it with this. I'm sorry. You said straight after you finish the tea, you would like to add up more tea. That's what you said to me, right? Oh, you could do it. You could do it from second cup, because the water, it's better from second cup to do it. You do it second cup and you add it in from the second cup.
What if the tea leaves are still in Chaniki?
Second cup.
Second
cup is
okay.
Yeah, second cup is okay.
What if before Shabbat we add a little bit and then we just add more later? Can we do that?
Not from first cup. Not from first source of the heat. You do it from second cup only. Okay?
Are you allowed to mix, like, you know, you have your cranberry juice? And my kids like to put salts in the cranberry juice to make it sparkly. Are you allowed to do that?
Yes, even though you're allowed to do this either this way or either this way, it doesn't matter. There is no coloring in the drinks. They are allowed to do this, there's no problem. Or petel, you know, in Israel is where you found, they take concentrated strawberry strawberry juice or concentrated grape juice or whatever. And they mix, it's very heavy, you know, it looks like a honey. They put it inside and they mix it with the salsa. You allowed to do this on Shabbat? Yes, you allowed to do this, yes.
Just to clarify, so if I put those tea leaves into the third cup, and then it becomes sort of old one, let's say, then I can pour it back into the teapot, which is the first...
No, it's the second.
Second,
right?
Yes,
you allowed to, yes, you allowed to do this. Okay, so Peter, to mix the concentrated juices with water, you're allowed, even though the water will be color of the juice in the end, eventually, you're allowed to do this, there's no prohibition for that. Shehent v'yav mashkib. Okay?
Rabbi Daniel?
Yes.
Also, like, I started doing like lemonade, for example, you take frozen fruits, strawberry, blueberry, and you put some hot water on top, and the color changes. Can you do that on Shabbat?
This is a problem of boiling. It might be a problem of the boiling. So
if you boil, I take the water from the pot. I do the three cups, and then I...
Third cup, if you did third cup, yes.
So then the whole lemonade becomes pink. It
doesn't matter, yeah.
Okay.
Because we said there's no... The law of coloring is... There's no coloring.
Because
right.
I did it, and somebody said, you're not allowed to do it, so I stopped doing it. So now I
have
to do it.
But let's say somebody does need this color.
What?
Somebody does need the color of those fruits. Let's say your case.
Right.
He doesn't need the lemonade. He wants the color of the fruits. He likes the color, and then he's going to use it after Shabbat in order to color certain things. So let's say somebody does need that. For drinking, permit it. But let's say somebody needs the color. So halacha is, even in those cases, in this case, for the food, since it's not for the food, since it's for the color, you're not going to be allowed to do this. But since you do it only to drink, you don't need the color, you need to drink the drink.
For the flavor of the fruits.
Right, you're allowed to do this. If you do it from a third cup, there's no prohibition to do it. But with the strawberries and those things, you have to be careful with the insects. If they are full of insects, you have to be very carefully. And once we bought raspberry.
Even if you freeze it?
Okay, let me just explain you, maybe you don't have, even frozen bugs are prohibited. It doesn't matter how, it doesn't matter how do you eat them, roasted, frozen, chopped.
Whole strawberries, frozen. The blackberries are kind of yours.
Okay, let me just explain you, since you eat this.
We need to learn about this.
Ladies. Can you listen? Okay, can you just listen? Okay, fine. Halacha is, there are three types of shratim the Torah writes about. There are three types of insects the Torah writes. One of the water bugs in water. They develop in water. Anything in the water, any creature in the water that doesn't have scales and swim and fins and scales, it's considered tameh for us. It's considered impure for us. We're not allowed to eat it. Crabs and, you know, the cockroaches in the water. They eat it, but we're not allowed to eat it. The only thing we're allowed to eat from water, it's a fish that has scales. That's a main sign for the kosher. It has to have scales. And it has to be cooked by a Jew in the kosher parts. Okay? Is it understandable? Okay. Now, any other things, any other creatures in the water, from tiny, tiny small ones to big ones, they prohibited for us to be tameh, contaminated. We're not allowed to eat. Somebody who eats them, it contaminates his soul because it goes into his soul, into his blood. And blood is the soul of the person, it's connected inside. And that's how it affects it spiritually him, that he becomes metum tam. In translation to say, I don't know how to say it in English proper way, so you...
Confusing them.
Mitumtam, it's I don't know if other word for stupid, but I'm telling you, mitumtam, it becomes mitumtam, it means...
Ignorant,
or he becomes totally outside of the holiness, he doesn't want to be holy, he doesn't care about Kedusha, he doesn't care about the Torah, spirituality, he doesn't care about this. That's how it cools him off. The food is very important to be blood kosher.
No.
Second, this is a water. The second type of bugs, they crawl on the crawling creatures on the land. The third type of bugs is flying bugs. As too easy to be easy to remember, from going from bottom to the top, the punishment is elevated also. Somebody who ate a complete bug, even small, not kazayit, a small bug, he ate. So alacha is he gets if it's from the water, he gets 5 times 39 lashes. He is obligated by Torah. If it's crawling on the land, 6 times 39 lashes. If it's flying, it's a 7 times 39. Why? Because it's repeated in Torah for the water bugs. 5 times it's repeated in Torah. For the crawling bugs, 6 times repeated in Torah. Mm-hmm. For the flying bugs, it's 7 times repeated in Torah.
Why would anybody willfully eat it? If people eat it, it's probably
nuts. Okay, so that's, you're right, but the problem is, did you see the greens that we use for the food?
Yeah.
Regularly, they are infested. So how do I know that? Last time, infested, zotomeret yesh shama charakim bifnim. So one time we made a checkup for the mashgichim, and one of the mashgichim, he brought this light box. You know, it's a light box.
Yeah.
It's such a structure with a white panel, and on the bottom there's a light. It's very easy to spot the insects with this box. You could do it at home even. So now, he brought a regular bunch of ukrop. How do you say ukrop? The dill. He just banged it twice on that light box and take it away. The whole thing was crawling creatures. I was shocked. Myself, I was shocked. I don't eat so much greens. But when he did it like this, he says, this batch is infested. And it's impossible to clean. It's very hard because they are so tiny and they were crawling.
So even if you soak in the water,
I looked like this. I didn't see that. But it banged, it came out. I said, listen, we probably had it in your hands. So let's check another one. He took the alfioche, the
cilantro.
He did the cilantro, it didn't come out. So I said, probably clean. He said, now we have to wash it very well. And now I'll teach you how to wash it proper way. Salty water, in order to help, it has to be so much salt that it could dissolve the bug itself.
Oh my God.
But we don't do so much salt. So the best way to clean it, buy a food soap. Do you know food soap is?
Yeah.
Sell it in a natural store.
Is that a chemical also, that food soap?
Natural.
That's what you said.
At least it is safe to use on a soup. Yeah, make sure it's kosher. Yeah, but it cleans out. What do you do? You have to dilute it in the water. The only thing you need, the which effect you need, if you don't have food soap, you could use dish soap. You still could use it. It has to have effect of slippery effect. The bugs, the only way they hold to the leaves because of their legs. So what happens, they hold on to the leaves and they don't let it go, even you wash it. So how do you do that? You make them slip. So in order to check it well, you would buy for yourself a white pot. It has to be white. Or clear, and you put on the clear pot a white towel. It's very easy then to see. Clear is better, why? Because then you could pick up and see to the light if on the bottom something falls. So what do? You put it in a soapy water. You keep it there for 5-10 minutes, and you start to wash it. Then wash it with the clean water, and once you pick up all the greens, you would examine the water itself very carefully while it's not moving. You will examine the water if something left. And if you see nothing left after washing so many times, you could rely on the chazakah that you do not have bugs inside.
You have to check the...
Myself, I will check every piece separately. But halacha is not, you're not required to check every piece separately. It's a chumrah. Okay? Okay. Gush Katif, I have seen also bugs inside, not from Gush Katif. The problem is with the bugs, they're getting on the way here. Gush Katif, it's a hamamot. How do you say hamamot? It's a greenhouse grown vegetables. And they seems to be less infested. But the problem is, on the way here, they get infested. Because all the flies and everything sits on it, leaves the egg. Once egg is there and it's hot enough, it grows up. Now, and as a sof, as yesh chazaka. That's why we call chazaka. What's a chazaka? Chazaka, it means you cleaned it very well, you looked at it like this, you didn't see anything suspicious. Once you wash it very well and you, in the water, you don't see anything after you did with the soap, you can use it. Halacha is you can use it. And mostly, in the winter time, they don't have so much insects. Why? Insects, they're not developing so fast. But it might be batches of full insects. So then we should be careful with using it. Yes.
Are you familiar with dry and cut?
If it has
cilantro,
now the law with the dry spices, first of all, it has to have a reliable kosher supervision. It's number one.
Right.
Number two, the law says any creature without spines, which are insects, if they stay over 6 months, they dry up, they die, they dry up, and they melt. Now, melted creature is not as a whole creature. Yes. Yes, yes. That's a permission they use in dry cilantro. Even though they wash it. Even though something left, let's say something left, they keep it for 6 months to dry. Once it dried, they melt it. Once it melted, even though it was there, now it's melted and dissolved. And even now, the law with this is 1 to 60, and exactly, you have 1 to 60 with the bugs. So therefore, they permit to use that. But again, you have to have reliable kosher sign on it, or you, okay, Starkate, reliable kosher sign on it. Okay? Yes.
So even with the lettuce, when you're washing the lettuce, you have to check the water, and not necessarily check the water in the lettuce.
I check, even though we wash everything, before I eat, I check everything with the lettuce, because the lettuce problem is while you're eating on the table, sometimes fruit flies, they go around. Have you ever seen fruit flies at home? They're small, tiny fruit flies. Yeah, and what happens when they sit on something and it has a water, they cannot fly back. They just stick and they stay there. Now I'll tell the story what happened with me. Mamash Hashem Shomer Israel, HaKadosh Baruch Hu Chasdei Hashem, it's because of mercy of Hashem, Hashem saved me for many times from that sea. Once I was sitting on a Brit Yitzchak with one of my students, and I took a piece of pineapple. I was holding in my hands, and somebody said Kvod Harav B'chavod, and I'm going to eat now in the middle. So I kept it in my hand and started to give drasha, and I was keeping in my hand and giving God blessings and talking. He saved me. Listen carefully. What happened? And then I just wanted to say Baracha, Baruch Atah, and I look like this. You can't believe it. I was holding a bug between my hands, and this was small bug who got stuck to this pineapple, and because pineapple is sweet, and with the juice it got stuck, and I was holding with my hands. If he would not stop me from eating it, I just would pick up, say Baracha, and eat it. And Baruch Hashem, Bizkut HaTorah, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, Bizkut Chasdei Hashem, Hashem saved me. No, it's under my hand. I said, Baruch Atah. And I said, guys, look at that. This is on Brit Yitzchak. On Sukkot, we see it, Yom Tov, Simcha, Ishtabach Shemo, my students, my family, all together. We're sitting with the kids, we enjoy. And Lachaim, Lachaim, Simchat Yerushalayim, you know? Fine. We do Lachaim, and they gave me, you know, after Lachaim, they give something to swallow the Lachaim. And they gave me an onion, a scallion. It was clean. I'm very makpid. It was clean, but it's Sukkot, it's outside. So they gave me onion. So I said, even I drink, I have to see what's inside. No matter how it burns inside now, I have to see what's inside it. So I opened the onion, and you cannot believe it. Inside, in between two of those, one guy was sitting, partisan. He's sitting there, he's waiting, when are Daniel going to taste me? So what did I do? What did I do? So I said, Rabotai, it's Mama Zeh Hashem, it's Mama Shifu HaKadosh Baruch Hu shows us Nisei Nisim, Sukkah. I said, go take it over everybody and show it to everybody. My children, they took it to everybody, said, look what Abba found, how you have to be careful with that. And Rabotai, yeah, I tell sometimes to people who don't check the cilantro and anything, you say, what bracha do you say for this greens? He said, what if you don't? I say, you're wrong, you have to say shakol. Because you eat insects. You eat meat more than you eat... Okay, that's another story. Once I'll tell you another story. My son grabbed something. He was like 1.5 years old. Look how Yetzarara want to make the children's hearts stupid. I'm sorry for expression. That they will not be able to learn Torah, no spirituality in their hearts. He grabbed something, dry fruit, dry apricot, and right away put it in the mouth. I run to him, take it from his mouth. And what do you think? I said, we don't eat it so fast, we have to split it. I split it, there's a dry worm inside of it. That's a Maaseh She'ayah. I'm telling you stories what happened. Tu Bishvat, one Tu Bishvat, we sit together. We eat the dry fruits, you know, those dry fruits, I'll tell you, that's a minhag was in the places that they do not have fresh fruits. Today, Baruch Hashem, we do have fresh fruits. So buy fresh fruits instead of dry fruits. Figs especially. I opened the fig, there is a big worm, dry worm inside of the fig. What did I do? I took a picture of that fig, I sent a file to everybody to see the Rabotai. People sometimes they just swallow it.
Okay, what about dates?
Dates also, if they pit it, the pitted dates.
Pitted dates.
Meaning with no pits, right? With no pits, regularly they are infested. If they are old, they are infested. So you have to be very careful. Each date, even if it has a peat, first of all, when you choose the dates, don't choose them like this. I choose them one by one and look around. I see there's no holes from outside. Then when I bring the home, I would like to eat it. I split it first, I open it, I examine it from all over. I see there is no insect. I take away the peat, then I say beracha, then I eat it. You have to be very careful, and you should know. For that mitzvah, to be careful with the food, Hashem will save you always to be careful with the food, and Hashem will never bring you something that you don't eat. Yes?
Preferably, what kind of water should you wash in? Cold, hot, warm?
What? Greens?
Vegetables, yeah.
A warm water should not be.
Which
not
water
be,
would actually like cold water is going to like make them.
No, it's not going. You see, freezing also. What helps freezing? They're going to be frozen and stuck. But then still, you have to wash them. Frozen bugs also prohibited by Torah. Rabotai. Yes.
What about, so raspberries? I heard that raspberries and
blackberries.
Blackberries are all.
Who have? They have.
It's possible
to clean it. The only way to clean them, I don't know if it's possible to clean them. I don't think so it's possible to clean them. The only if you take it from places that are cold and they grown in greenhouses. When it's cold, they cannot develop. They cannot reproduce. It's cold.
What about things like broccoli and caliber?
Broccoli, the tops, you have to be very careful with the tops because they are infested on tops. But the stems, it's very easy to clean. You wash it well. You look it around. If you don't see anything there,
also
suspicious.
Yeah.
What?
Celery.
You have to open. If you see outside, it's clean. Regularly, I don't eat celery like this.
Inside,
I chop it.
You
so.
Celery inside.
You do have it, and I'll tell you Motzei Shabbat story also. Once on Motzei Shabbat, we decided to take out the food. I'll not tell you from which restaurant. Glad Kosher, very famous, and everybody eating there. It might be Ashmata. It happens sometimes, you know. And Baruch Hashem, it happened with me, nobody else. I was sitting. I said a motzi lechem. They brought a soup from this restaurant, put it in front of me. I was young then. I used to eat from restaurant. Now Baruch Hashem, I try not to. But they brought me soup. Motzei Shabbat. I say Motzei Lechem, and while saying Motzei Lechem, suddenly soup turns like this, and I see worm, mamash worm, in the soup. So I took it. It was connected to a piece of celery, and I knew from which restaurant is that. I took this whole soup. I went to the restaurant next day, and I called the Mashgiach. I said, listen, there's a problem with here. Maybe you're not checking the celery here well. And I explained this situation. Hasidic guy was there. And I told him, listen, we will be very careful with that. And now what do you like? You would like another portion of celery? I said, no. Enough. So give me my money back. He paid me back money and I left. But you should be careful. Whenever mass production of the food is involved, it's very hard to be careful with the food. And especially those cruises. They go to cruise La Kosher, 4,000 people to feed La Kosher. You need at least 50, 60, 100 mashgichim, the supervisors, to stand that food. And it's very hard. And especially people who go away for Pesach. They, you know, like easy life. How could you go away for Pesach, Rabotai, when somebody does the... I understand you have many kids, it's very hard. But the whole Pesach is to feel the Pesach, how we were tired while being slavery, right? While being in the slavery. But still, to oversee the whole food and what they do there, you need a lot of supervisors. And regularly what they have one Mashgiach running around and doesn't know what he's doing.
Even the Black Kosher restaurants, once I came myself, I came early to the Shmokas bar, and they were opening the berries from the containers and putting them on the fruits without even washing it.
Here you go.
And I used to laugh eating, now I can't even touch those berries. They don't even rinse them in the water.
It's
a glad kosher restaurant.
What could I tell you? Rabotai, it's a big problem with that. So be careful with this. Yes.
Like if it's a blueberries. We're supposed to soak.
Blueberries, you could wash them well and see them around because they are big, they don't have holes inside.
Yeah.
Then you just look, if they're big and good, you could see. But still, when you eat it, just cut them in half. You cut it yourself with the mouth and you see if something there. Because sometimes, from the stem, it goes inside and ruins inside, not outside. In a cold weather, it's not found so much. Yes.
So raspberries, strawberries,
blackberries. You should try to avoid it. You should try to avoid it.
Avoid eating this?
Right. Because most of the cases is found to be infested. Or you check every piece. How do you check every piece? You wash it well, there's a soapy water and everything. And if you put them on the lamp or something a little bit hot temperature, they start to come out. Because they inside. When it's hot, they cannot stay inside.
With broccoli, I washed it well, and I steamed it on the monthly day, and like worms started coming out of it.
Because when it's warm, they cannot stay inside. They run away. If you put a white towel, like straight towel and a blanket, and you put this while heated on them with a lamp, you know sometimes they put heating lamp on top, you will see them crawling all around. So you have to be very careful.
Bodig
you could rely because it's a big company and they do have professionals working on it and they buy from the beginning things from the hamamot, from the greenhouses. Right. They use most of those things. Okay, yes. I don't know. I don't trust no Bodig, I trust myself. On the table we have a lettuce. What do? I taught my kids even to do this. We pick it up to the light. We saw it very good. And I taught them any doubt that they see, they have to take it away. And that's from both sides we check and then we eat.
What about lettuce? Cabbage.
Nice.
Cabbage.
Huh?
Cabbage.
Again, what do I do with the cabbage? I personally used to check every time, every leaf, and I used to see on outside majority of the bugs. But sometimes on the market itself, when I buy a cabbage, I just cut off a couple of leaves and I see if it's good. If I don't see so much, if I don't see anything, cabbage is full, I don't see any damages outside.
You mean like
hold? Just a second. I take it home. Then I cut it open. I try to go as much as possible with the leaves to open them and to wash them very well and to see. If I see outside of the leaves they are clean, it's very hard to know if they went inside because cabbage is very tight, and regularly in winter time with the cabbage is easier. You understand? Because they grow it again in a greenhouse.
So
yes.
You have to clean
but it's
every
still,
leaf, right?
I do clean every leaf, but inside whatever left, it's so much not found there, so you don't have to even to bother. You could just wash it well and that's it. You could use it.
And also mention the grape leaves. They have so much.
Please, don't. Alim Shel Gefin, you have to wash them well before the use and you have to check them. I found bugs on top of them. What?
I've never found bugs and I clean.
Do you know what you're looking for? You know what? Maybe Bli Neder, next time I'll bring you a book that talks about those bugs and you will see the pictures of those bugs.
I mean, with the strawberries, I peel the whole skin.
Strawberry, I peel. That's the best way.
But with
I'll tell you another story I remembered. Once I sat in my in-law's house and somebody came there, not so religious. So I was talking about things. They told me to give the retorah. So I was talking the retorah. And then the thing came out for the, you know, somebody didn't wash something on the table. Greens didn't wash. So they asked to bring it to washed already. And I said that the reason is for that is because of bugs. And that guy started to make fun of it. You know, bugs, come on, what are you talking about? Where do you see bugs? I said, even a small fruit like that, and I pointed, could have a sea bug. He takes the fruit. It was tomato, cherry tomato. On a stem, you know the cherry tomatoes on a stem?
Yeah.
He takes this fruit and says, how could this fruit has a bug? I said, check it, you will see. He was shocked. He picks up the stem and you see on the stem, Rabotai, on the stem, there is a worm sitting there. And he said, Rabbi, like this to me, you defeat me.
Yeah.
He was shocked himself. I didn't know what is that. I just, even that thing. Story with me after Tisha B'Av, Rabotai, look how Yetzer Hara works with a person. We, after Tisha B'Av, hungry like after Yom Kippur, you know, and especially in the summer. I had a small headache, I came home, drank the water a little bit after Tisha B'Av, and we started the food. My uncle has a small yard where he plants tomatoes. So he got, on the way home, he got some tomatoes and went inside. So we washed them, and we wanted to eat. They were, you know, no pesticides, no chemicals, natural. Okay. And listen to this natural. Why don't, in those natural, you don't have bugs, and those you do? Because it's natural. Bugs will not go to the chemistry. So what happens? So I decided to split one in half. You don't believe. In a stem, place where it's connected to the stem, the bug went inside of the tomato and leave there. And I cut it, and I saw him crawling out. I said, wait, don't eat it. You cannot eat it. You have to cut it. You have to see what it's
cherry like. Cherry tomatoes, you cannot eat whole like
you
that.
Should be careful. I'm just saying to you, not every tomato has it. But you have to be careful.
How does it go inside? It's closed.
That's what I'm saying. I didn't imagine even. What probably happened, I'll tell you. When it's developed, the zvuv, the fly would come and lay an egg over there. And when it will grow, it will go inside already from there.
Huh?
Yeah. So what will happen about I, and it was not so pleasant, you know, to, when you're hungry and you want to eat it, and to see such a thing crawling out of the tomato, I said, Chas le Hashem, Hashem saved me, Baruch Hashem, yes.
Even for a very, very known hashgachad, for strawberries to be clean, are they allowed to leave any green stem at all?
No.
So what if I saw it at a very religious place, and I came up to the Mashgiach and I said, I learned in seminary, this has to be out. And he said, oh, he started giving me explanations. The whole strawberry was there, and the green part was also still there. Mm-hmm. Not the leaf, just
the stem
like that inside.
And
they never cut that green completely.
Well, you have to see. You have to check.
That's
sometimes.
That's the prettiness. They're not going to sit there cutting it because then it's going to look ugly, and they have to cut out sticks to put in chocolate. So they're not going to like make ugly strawberries.
That I don't know. You have to check. Every strawberry you have to check on your own. It's not concerned.
We tell the hashgachah to go check them again.
Well, I don't know. Maybe. But again, I'm telling to you, you responsible for yourself. Once my student went to one of the restaurants on 108, Glad Kosher, so he came and they gave him broccoli. So he was very suspicious with my student, you know, broccoli, you know, Daniel doesn't permit, so he called the Mashgiach, said, listen, what's going on with this? Told him, no, don't worry, it's good, he told him, it's good. That's what he told him. And he said, but how could you clean that? Because it's very hard to clean the tops of the broccoli, it's very tidy. You cannot clean them every single piece. So what do you worry, he said, Mashgiach to him. When Beit HaMikdash is rebuilt, you will bring Korban, he told him. I said, it's unbelievable, rain check for Korbanot. He's always splitting Korban. Korban means sacrifice for the unintentional sin. So what he told him, it might be there, but it's unintentional. Eat it. Enjoy it. So I told him, you're not allowed to eat it even there. How could Mashgiach say such a thing, Sobotai? So you are a keret abayit. You are ikarosh el bayit. You are a foundation of the house. You're not basements. You're foundation of the house, right? You are foundation of the house. You are the foundation of the house. So be careful with the food. What you give to your children, be careful what you give to your husband. Because Rabotai, this damages the soul, and it's very damaging.
People who are, what are you saying, you can sound soul? People who did it before they knew anything, they came from...
How to do tshuva for that? First of all, person has to, the tshuva, first, he has to acknowledge it's prohibited. Second, he has to regret if he have done such a thing. Third, he has to confess in front of Hashem, confession with words. Stand up in your room, say, Ana Hashem, I beg you, Hashem, please forgive me. Maybe I overlooked, maybe I didn't eat proper food. Please forgive me. Mm-hmm. After you did vidui and charata, it's regret inside of yourself. If you cry, it doesn't bother also. It's good. Mm-hmm. After you did, that's what's called tshuva. Arizal fixes then, besides tshuva, there is a tikkun. Tshuva, it's from now and on. Tikkun, it's from now and to the past. You broke certain things. You broke your spiritual settings. You did certain averot chas v'shalom. You did something wrong. So what do? Now you do tikkunim. The tikkunim for ladies are much more easier for the men, but for the ladies, tikkun would be, for example, from this now on, to be careful to do the, with the food, let's say in the case of the bugs, to be careful with the bugs, and to make other lady, to teach her how to be careful with the bugs. One lady called me from Atlanta. She found out about me that people call about the tikkunim, and she asked me, she made an abortion, which would be ritzicha, according to some poskim. She killed a baby, and she asked me if she has a remedy for that. I said, for everything there's a remedy. So what do I say? I said to her what to do tikkun, and I said, you not now also need tshuvat ha-mishkal. What's tshuvat ha-mishkal? How much weight, quote-unquote, you put on accusation scale. Now so much zchuyot, and merits, you have to put on merit scale. So, to make it even, you understand? Because once you do the sin, there's accusation on you. Once you make a mitzvah, it goes on the merit side. So how much I have to do? I said, at least go and make some woman who do want to make an abortion, make them not to make it. Talk to them. Tell them that you went through it. Tell them how harsh is this. Yes.
Rabbi, I don't mean to impose, but people can support Efrat. There's an organization called Efrat.
Efrat, right.
They go actively convincing the girls not to abort.
Right.
So that would be $1,800, it's $1,200 for 1 year to save a child.
Right.
That's the tikkun.
Also, it's an achenami, to give money for that. Tzedakah tzin mevayet, also to give money. But sometimes people are not able to give so much.
Even if you're on the 20-year plan, Dr. Shusheim, I think there's an article about that there.
Right. Efrat, they saved a lot of babies. You know, so ladies in Israel, how many abortions they made? B'nai Yisrael. Over 1 million kids.
Wow.
1 million kids got destroyed. And you know, Gemara says, when a child has Olam Abba, you know when a child has Olam Abba? Gemara says, from the times of conception. Once the child concepted, over there the folder opened, they right away assigned him for Olam Abba. And they destroy this child, not even coming to this world. Yes?
I have a question back to the food. Now, when we want to bake something, we want to use flour with sifted.
But when we buy bread, do they sift the flour in the bakery shops? How do they sift the flour?
Okay, let me just tell you the story that I had.
Question.
When I came to the bakeries on the Main Street, they told me they
can
do not
the question for the people who
sifting
have
the flour. Mm-hmm. Regularly, if flour overstays for a long period, it starts to get bugs from eggs laid there, and it's a lot of bugs. And how could you see it? Very easy. You put it on a surface flour and make it smooth. In 20 minutes, you will see lines. That's footprints of the bugs. You have to be very careful. You will see lines. Yes. Not every flour has it. Don't get nervous and frustrated. Okay, which sifter you allowed to use? I saw ladies using a big sifters. That's not good, definitely. There's a Badat sifter that's sold, and this takes quite time. It takes like 10 minutes to sift like whole thing.
That's yours, right?
Yes. It's very small. But okay, now, but they, American flour, it's pre-sifted by law. They require to pre-sift it to finest that, but still it doesn't say that the store shelves do not have bugs. Store shelves, they do have bugs. So be careful when you buy a flower, number one, be careful that the bag, the paper bag has to be sealed. How do you check it? If you go like this to the bag, if you see the flower coming out from the sides, it's a sign that it has a hole. Right, and it's a first, you do like this, and you see that because of pressure of air, the flour goes outside.
Sometimes it's just because it's just dirty. Not because
it is true, so you have to see. You just have to see.
But even the Keruch Yesham have to see?
You're right, yes. Now, once you took it, and it's clean, and you keep the flour, once you sifted it, keep it in a plastic bag with no holes. Some people, they keep in a plastic, double plastic bag in the refrigerator. Why? Right?
Yeah.
To keep it there in order not to get any bugs should not get there. Okay? That's another thing. If you keep many things closed and tightly closed, it's very hard to get the bugs. Now I test also beans at home. Already for 8 months, I kept the beans in closed jar to see if from inside of the beans would somebody come out. Because regularly, how do you see the sign that came out? If you turn like this, you will see the scent over there.
Yeah.
Like this, it's eggs.
Oh,
it's an egg. Scent.
Yeah.
Scent.
Yeah.
Like
sand.
A sand on the bottom.
Sand.
It's actually laid eggs, dry eggs of the mold.
Can I ask?
No, I didn't see. That batch didn't have. And Baruch Hashem, I could use it, there's no problem.
Mm-hmm.
That's another way. Now, just a second.
Can I keep beans in the freezer?
Well, if he still you have to check them. Halacha is, you see if it's whole thing, it's not damaged. Beans, before you use, you also soak them. And if most of them, you would see some beans, they will go up because it has an air pack inside.
Yeah.
Air pack inside, it shows that there is a hole and it might be developed by bug who ate up.
So those beans that are not supposed to.
Those beans you throw out. And then you just look over if the beans are shalem, they're full. They're not cracked, they're not broken. If it's broken, you could just open it and see if there's nothing inside, you just go. Yes.
So I thought if I put the beans in like a pot and then I put water over it, much more beans rise up if I do it the other way. Which way are you supposed to soak the beans?
Doesn't matter. You just mixed it like this, and anything that has to come out will come out itself.
So going back to the bakery, so when we buy the bread at the bakery shops,
they do not sift. I went all the bakeries, they do not sift. I went to the pizzeria and I said to them, listen, he says the Ashgachad do not require us to sift things.
Do no bakeries sift? There's no.
Maybe they changed. Listen, I went like 3 years ago when I started to do my own bread. I don't buy bread so much outside, but I went 3 years ago and asking them if they do sift things. And they said no. The only bakery I heard, it's Stern's Bakery in Brooklyn.
They sift?
Stern's Bakery in Brooklyn, I think they do sift. Hasidisha Bakery.
Is there any stuff
that they
send here, Stern's?
Yes, Stern's. They have a lot of Stern's cookies. Yeah. אני לא יודע, זה תלוי, תתקשרו, תשאלו. You could call the company anytime. Let's say you call OK, and you would ask, you gave on such a product the thing. We would like to know if they do sift their flour. You say they yes, according to Halacha, you could rely on them. They would not lie to you. Now the question my student had, it's already late. My student had a question in regards to Bishul Israel Franks, the sausages.
Hot dogs.
Hot dogs. It's not healthy, yeah, it is. But he wanted to eat if it's Bishul Israel or not, because they already pre-cooked. So he called the company, Empire Company, and they said, we don't know, speak with this person, representative. And he called OU, and he answered him, yes, it is Bishul Israel. You see, you could find out things. And they are relied in this. They cannot lie to you. And if they lie, they will take care, HaKadosh Baruch Hu will take care of them already. But I'm just saying to you, they cannot lie to you in terms of Halacha, because they are Mashgichim, they have to say the truth. Okay? You could rely on them.
My husband said, well, like George, he said paper towels were not supposed to use to put food on it or something.
Right. The hot
they
food.
Use with the glue.
Hot food. I'll tell you what happens with the paper towels or Bounty in the book of Blumenkranz, Rabbi Blumenkranz, he wrote that they use a certain oil in order paper towels should be absorbent and good. Holy, they in some of them they use a fat of chazir. So you have to be so what they, I saw women doing what? They taking a fish, fried fish, put it on paper towel.
That's right.
And it might be bayah. Maybe now they changed it. Maybe okay, let me just explain about the processing processes of everything what going on around. Our world changed dramatically. They use everything possible to do their product the best. And it doesn't matter what it takes. Mm-hmm. Now, if they need fat of the trefus and everything, they would use it even in a paper to be so absorbent and strong, not to rip. They would do this. The only thing is, we have to see the books who researched it. And Rabbi Blumenkranz, even though he's machmir, but he researched those things. That it might be changed. The processes, they change. For example, I knew the Crest toothpaste, they used to put shark skin inside. Yes, 5 years ago. Now I saw the good Crest toothpaste. I called them from the store. I called them 1-800 number. I asked them, I waited for 2 minutes. I asked them if they have any animal ingredients in this. They said no. Then I asked them any bi animal ingredients inside of it. They would take bones, they would turn them in something else, and then they will mix it.
It doesn't say that in the ingredient, but it says.
Do you understand anything what they write in the ingredients?
No. So what
did you say? Chemical major.
So, you, have,
so
I,
you do.
Before I buy something, actually, I search what ingredients is.
Okay, let me tell you. Many chemicals, what they write, sometimes,
so
most of the time, chemicals, they derive from animal source. Mm-hmm. So you have to be careful. Whoever in chemical industry, he knows that.
Well,
today, gelatin, they started to do from beans. It's no problem today. But tens of years ago, gelatin was from the bones of the animals.
Okay.
Now, changed everything. So I called the company Crest, I said, this toothpaste, this product, does it have any animal ingredients? They said, if they ask you why you're asking this, don't say it's kosher information. Say it's allergic information.
Mm-hmm.
Or they get petrified right away. So they have to tell you the truth. And they said, no animal ingredients. Vitamins. With the vitamins, you don't know the story. I went to the GNC once. It was like 15 years ago, doctor told me multivitamin. So I took the multivitamin, and it says kosher on it, just the word kosher with no sign on it. It's kosher multivitamin for men. So I called the guy who was in charge of the store. I said, are you sure it's kosher? Who is authorized? It's kosher? No, don't worry. This is shelf. Everything's kosher here. So I took the one, I saw one at 100 Nabi Day. By law, they're required to put it there. So I called the company, do you have a rotary phone? I said, yes, I have a rotary phone. I cannot press the buttons, not to wait. So right away, they picked up representative and they told me, I asked them, do you have any animal ingredients in that? She said, no, no, don't worry, no animal ingredients. Before I put down my phone, she said, wait, I found something. And she told me what it has inside. It had some animal ingredients in it, okay? So
vitamins?
Yeah. In the vitamins. More
yeah,
time.
They use from ground bone.
It is, has to be kosher. You have to be very careful. Rabotai, today with the processing foods, processing... This book would speak. This book would speak about it. Mostly it's a chemical.
Imagine in the Gemara or somewhere in the sources, isn't it like acceptable if it's less than 0.001%?
Okay, let me just explain you this. This is
cough medicine is not kosher, but if you're sick, you better take it.
Okay, let me just explain you in this issue.
It has to be proportions.
Okay, good. Anything that prohibited from Torah, so with this question we'll finish the shiur. Anything that prohibited by Torah, we're not allowed to dilute it to the 0.0 by hands. Let's say it was, like in case of the dried bugs. It already was. They already did it, and I don't see the bugs here. If I see the leg of the bug, I'm not allowed to eat it. But if it's mixed, and mixture is 1:60, it's permitted. That's halacha. Now, the same thing with a... Sometimes most of the chemicals that they use in the pharmacies, they are chemicals. There's no animal ingredients. We ask about the aspirin and all this Tylenol and everything. It's a chemical, total chemical. There's no question. But certain do have. For example, anything that Chole She'en Bo Sakana, he is allowed to use this medicine. There's no problem. But let's say he's not Chole She'en Bo Sakana. He just needs like vitamins, supplemental food. In this case, since it goes like a food, not as a medicine, you will have to have Ashgacha on that food. You understand? For the medicine, it's not such a big deal. If it's mixed, if it's byproduct, and it's chemical made, there's no problem with this. Okay? But that's the rule in this. But lachatchila levatel isur beyadayim asur. Let's say somebody has a milk and he says, I know 1:60 is permitted. Can he take a soup, meat soup?
No, with it?
So that's the kind of thing is that. You're not allowed to buy hands. But if mistakenly it fell, then you will call rabbi and ask, it was 1:60, it was not 1:60, it was hot, it was cold, how it was.
Let's go back to the Crest, the toothpaste.
Right.
It had the byproduct up until 5 years ago, for instance. Can we still use it to brush our teeth?
According to halacha, since you do enjoy that taste, and you do enjoy, if you feel that taste of an animal taste there, which make it more enjoyable or whatever, for the odor, for the whatever, you're not allowed to. But since it's a byproduct, logically you're allowed to, since you're not eating it, and you spit it, and the good taste is not because of that animal.
No.
That's it. Then in this case, you're allowed to use it. And this book of Rabbi Blumenkranz is a very good book. You buy it once a year on Pesach. It has all information on something that you do not have a kosher authorization. Anything that you do not have, you look into this book, it will tell you if it's good to use it or not.
Where does it come out?
Can they show you one every year?
Yes. Every year updated.
Now when does it come out? When does it come out?
Regularly, one month before Pesach, you would go to the Jewish stores, you would find it there, bookstores, okay?
Frozen fruits and vegetables, do they have that hashkafa on it?
Yes. If it's 100% natural, they do not use any
vitamin.
For example,
organic. Organic.
You could rely, if it's not cooked, you could
frozen
rely.
Frozen strawberries, frozen peas.
You could rely, but still you have to check them for the
bugs.
Yes,
definitely. But
that's you're allowed to use them.
It's natural.
Yeah. What they say on top of it. Okay, if they say it's clean, you could use it. Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
But you still have to check.
Yeah, petriot also you have to check. How do you call this? Mushrooms you have to check. You have to be careful with the mushrooms. It has the bugs. Yes.
Back to the insects. I heard that if they're cut up, sliced, whatever, and it ends up in the food, you're allowed to eat it because it's cut up.
The bug you're not allowed to eat. The portion
no,
of the bug.
Not gonna eat
mixture.
Breakfast.
The mixture you're allowed to eat, not the bug. Yeah. Let's say.
But
again.
Sliced up, diced, the bug, let's say. You can't
again.
Eat them like that. It's in the mix.
Again. Let me just to clarify that. The same case we had with the dry cilantro. What's the permission to use it, even it has a bug, because bug already melted. But let's say if you do find the leg of a bug, can you eat it? No. The leg is prohibited. But the mixture is permitted. In this case, if you cleaned it well, you washed it, and then you sliced it also, that would help to permit it more even.
But I put it into a blend processor.
Right.
So
it blends
it. Shreds it
yeah.
Finally.
Yeah, it's permitted, but you still have to wash it.
Oh, yeah.
You still have to wash it, yes.
I've got to do brushing teeth on Shabbat. Are we allowed, we're not allowed to brush teeth on Shabbat?
Brushing teeth on Shabbat.
Teeth on Shabbat.
Late already? Brushing teeth on Shabbat, according to Halacha, Rav Ovadia Yosef permits it.
Permits?
But you have to be careful if gums, they do not bleed. If you know for sure that gums, they do bleed, you should be using a mouthwash. That's the best solution.
Yeah, but you can use toothpaste.
So you can, yeah.
He says yes.
You can wash it afterwards also?
Well, no, brush, you leave it till after Shabbat. Electric brush is prohibited on Shabbat, yes. Надо открыть от ножки. Покупайте закрытые ножки. The stem, the stem of the petriya, of the mushroom, should be connected to the leg. That's the most, and when you wash it, when you open the stem, you will see everything that's going on. When you wash it well, and you check it. You have to buy with Ashgacha. Ashgacha. You have to be very careful. You have to check. You could buy it. If it's not cooked, you could buy it, but then you have to check it. You have to check it. You have to check it.
Canned beans and all that, we also
have to check. It has a... It's cooked because it's cooked also.
Why toothbrush we have to leave after use?
Because you're preparing from a regular day, from Shabbat to regular day. You're not allowed to prepare from Shabbat to regular day. Yeah, it's late. Yes. The mitkare? Are we allowed or we're supposed to?
Are we allowed? Because I heard a lecture from someone who was very machmir, and she said that it's the rabbit in Florida, so they are not allowed to write the mitkare, and I have it in my too with
her. That's wrong. The rabbit in should be
not
going to be.
So the sick, and six times was written the mitkare as kitubah, and 16 years.
Maybe it was wrong. Maybe it was clean. Some demit kere, it means that also cold.
Yeah.
We have to write in Ketubah the most found names for that person.
Okay.
For example, you have certain name and there is a different name that people call you.
Yeah.
We have to write both of them because Ketubah is your document.
They put a dalet and a mem and they put a dash on top.
Well, it's demit kere. They write.
My husband has like four or five names that they call him.
Doesn't matter because they didn't have the space. That's why they put it.
Yeah.
Down, they wrote down because
so it's for that I have to meet
there. Can I have your number just to find me?